Okay, so I'm going to introduce Joe, and then I'll give the floor to Alberto, who will be chairing the session. So thank you everyone for joining the FMIX keynote talk session. We would like to welcome our keynote speaker, Dr. Joe Kinnearty. Joe is a principal scientist at Galois, where he leads several research programs on rigorous system design and verification. Joe is also the CEO and chief scientist of Free and Fair, where he works on applying formal methods to hardware security for the Department of Defense in order to help the world's elections and democracies be more trustworthy. Prior to joining Galois in 2014, Joe was a full professor at the Technical University of Denmark and the head of its software engineering section. Over the past decade, Joe has been a tenured professor at several universities in Denmark, Ireland, and the Netherlands. With such an impressive career in both academia and industry over the last 25 years, we feel extremely lucky to have Joe share his wisdom with us today through haunting tales of applied formal methods. I'll now give the floor to Alberto, who will be chairing this session.
Thanks a lot, Anastasia. There is not much I will be doing. Because then we are all eager to listen to Joe, and the expectations are very high. Anastasia was making sure that the expectations are high. So Joe, I'm sorry, but now the floor is yours. So we all have, we'll listen to you. And then for the Q&A, we'll see. People, please, in the audience, post questions in the Q&A, and then either Joe or I will pick the questions and address them.
All good. My face is hurting from smiling so much due to that introduction. So thank you so much. So I guess I should share my screen and we should get going. Thanks for having me here. It's very generous of you to invite me to talk. I see a lot of my friends in the audience, which is great. Hi, old friends. Sorry, I haven't seen you in recent years. How's the screen look?
It looks good.
Looks good? Alrighty. So today I'm gonna give a little talk about some storytelling around the kind of work that I've done over the past 25 years or so. First, I'm gonna give a little background on where I've been so that you know, understand where I'm coming from. And then we'll go down a list of a few stories which have a few morals or punchlines that I'm going to try to get across to you. And we're going to do this in sort of a fun way. This isn't going to be a boring talk. It's going to be memorable if for nothing else, then I'm going to include some media in the talk. And usually we'll see how that works out as a remote sort of thing. So firstly, some frame conditions on me. I've been doing computing since the early 80s. In the early days, doing both computer science sort of things and electrical engineering sort of things, like working on pinball machines and video games and some game programming and the like. And then I went to university and did computer science and mathematics and kind of dabbled in a whole bunch of areas, but you'll notice that none of those areas mentioned formal methods, because at the time I didn't have any professors at the universities I was attending that did formal methods. So I simply wasn't exposed to it. But I got this enormous background in a variety of different other areas, ranging from systems-like stuff to programming languages to software engineering. And that sort of grounded me well for future applied work. Then I went to industry for a few years and got my first taste there, but had an itch that I had to go back and finish my PhD. So I returned to Caltech, and that's where I was introduced to formal methods by multiple people at Caltech, as well as at professors from other universities with whom I interacted. And while I was at Caltech, because this was the boom years in the late 90s, I started and ran a number of companies while doing my PhD. So they got me exposed to more of the real world, so to speak. And in those occasions is where I first started to use formal methods in the real world while doing the PhD and learning lessons. And sometimes these lessons learned are from the mistakes that you make. And so some of the stories I'm going to tell are about those mistakes. Then I had my academic years. As mentioned before, I was at Radboud University Nijmegen, University College Dublin, the IT University of Copenhagen, and then the Technical University of Denmark. So I had a great time. I spent, you know, nearly half of my adult life in Europe. I definitely feel European. I've also lived in Italy and France for a while. And then I decided to ping pong and go back to industry. And that's when I returned to Galois in Portland, Oregon in about 2013. And I've been working here fully in the industrial hat on for the past few years. And while at Galois, we've done a number of different spin-outs that are much more applied than the core basic and applied research that Galois does, one of which is free and fair. So the frame conditions there, you know, some of you may have heard of Galois. We have something of a reputation in the formal methods discipline, but for those of you who haven't, Galois is 21 years old. We're an employee-owned company that operates in a peer-to-peer fashion. We now have a bit over 130 people, and our clients are mainly the US government and some other governments and some Fortune 100 companies. And we focus really on sort of applied formal methods for public good. We focus on defensive technology. We have a really strong boundary policy. We don't do any offensive cyber work. We don't do anything that gets close to a weapon of any kind. And we operate in a peer-to-peer fashion. So we're kind of like a computer science department where there's no rivalries and everyone wants to help each other, which is lovely as compared to some places that I'm aware of in the past. About once a year, we spin out a company to transition technology, but we only do that when there's a real market out there that demands a company that has a different shape than an applied research institution. And there's a desire for more product-oriented work. And Free and Fair is one such company. I've been causing trouble in elections as a academic hacktivist for 20-odd years. So if you heard about people hacking voting machines, or getting laws changed in positive ways to use computers in smart ways in countries like Holland and Ireland and Denmark and the USA, then it's likely my colleagues or myself or all the above causing trouble. The other spin-outs that we've done over the past handful of years include a company called Tosny, Formal Tech, Tangram Flex, MuseDev, and our newest spin-out just announced a few weeks ago that I've been helping out with is called Niobium Microsystems, which is commercializing some of the hardware work that I've been doing over the past few years. The other frame condition here is I'm going to tell some stories about the past, and because, you know, a lot of this is industrial work, and even though a lot of the work we do is eventually published or open source, I'm not going to pick on people. I'm not going to mention specific clients or specific projects. I don't want to harm anyone's feelings or reputation and the like. You know, most of what we do is unclassified, so there's no danger in touching anything like that, or there's no danger in stepping on NDAs, and a huge amount of our work is open source, but I'm not gonna cause any trouble. The main tools that we use at Galois that sort of connect to the work that I'm gonna describe are things like Haskell and SAT solvers and SMT solvers and logical frameworks, and then our own technology stack. But the set of tools in the toolbox for the subgroup that I run at Galois and the projects that I run is much, much larger and includes nearly 100 different formal methods related tools, technologies, methods, languages, et cetera. So in the examples I'm gonna give in a moment, I might mention a technology here or there, and that's relevant to the project in question. It's not necessarily relevant. You shouldn't take it as this is a tool that Galois uses universally across all its projects by any means, because in general, we always use the right tool for the job. And that means each sub project, depending upon the people acting in it, the PIs on the project, the client need, and the problems we have to solve determines what our toolbox is. So that's our framing for what we're going to talk about today. So lesson number one comes from Jerry Maguire. Now I'm going to play a video here, and I would like to hear from the chair if the audio comes through all right.
What you gonna do, Jerry?
Yes, the audio is fine.
Congratulations, you're still my agent.
All right. So those of you, many of the videos we're gonna see today are a little bit old. They may even predate the birth date of some of the folks in the session. But this is Jerry Maguire screaming, "Show me the money!" And the point of this tale is that almost every single time when I've written a proposal, especially in the industrial world, and I attempt to win a project to make an impact, If that proposal or the project really focuses on telling the story of formal methods and trying to explain the details, the technology, the underpinnings to a client that's evaluating the project and isn't a scientist in the discipline, then most oftentimes the proposal fails or the project doesn't succeed in the way that we want it to. The point here is that we shouldn't be selling formal methods per se. We should be selling the solutions and the impact that we make. So the show me the money is not so much show me the money like the money you're going to pay me. It's more like show me the impact that you're going to make in the project. So the proposals that we write these days, sure, it has elements that hearken to the foundation. So you have to cite that which you're building upon and that which you intend to do. But for the most part, we end up using evidence from past projects to tell the story of the project they're going to run and the impact it's going to have on the client and the client-customer relationship in particular. So don't sell Greek letters. Sell graphs that demonstrate the impact of what you're going to do. Sell storylines about how it's going to connect to the real-world customer instead. So that's lesson number one. And you know, every time you now see Jerry Maguire, I hope you think of don't sell formal methods, sell solutions. Lesson number two comes from Dr. Meredith from the movie Real Genius.
Never forget to check the references.
So Dr. Meredith says, always, no, never forget to check your references. Dr. Meredith is a distinguished professor at the institution in Real Genius. And he's trying to get across the point that you should always double check your foundations, double check your work. In this case, the story relates to the fact that many of the projects we run use some form of specification language to write formal models or formal descriptions of systems that we mean to build. And on more than one occasion, especially when we have junior researchers involved who maybe are doing this only for the second or third time in their careers, they end up writing models that are rich, expressive, capture what we think is appropriate for the system, and yet don't commonly run tools to evaluate those models' well-formedness or well-typedness or appropriate shape. For example, you might have a five-page long Kriptol model. Kriptol is a domain-specific language that we invent and use to describe bit-level operations, primarily cryptographic operations. So they might describe a cryptographic algorithm in five pages of formal specification, and yet never write down a property about that spec, never write down a lemma or a theorem about the spec. Even though they exist in the paper that we're reading or in the standard that we're reading from, no properties written down. And you ask yourself, well, how is that a thing? How's that possibly useful? Well, the specs are executable and you can use the specs in a variety of ways to do things like verify other artifacts or to run by simulation and the like. But if you don't have any properties written down, then you don't necessarily know your spec is well-formed in a deeper fashion. And in particular, it means that your spec likely has inconsistencies inside of it. We find this time and time again, where a large amount of specifications have been written about either source code or a formal model, and everything looks great. The tools say everything is great. The simulations seem to run well. You do things like vector-based testing or quick check style testing, and everything looks pretty good. But as soon as you turn your attention to doing any full-blown formal verification, everything falls apart. And it doesn't fall apart in a way that the junior person notices. They run their verification of, say, half dozen or a dozen different implementation fragments, and they all pass. And they think, man, I'm a genius. I got the spec right the first time. The implementation's right too. Everything's grand. And then we step in and we say, okay, try to verify the implementation assert false, the bottom most implementation. And the tool says, assert false. Yeah, that's great. That terminates. And you're like, oh gosh, specs are wrong. Something is wrong somewhere because now I'm inconsistent and I can prove false. And so it ends up being that our specification becomes technical debt. We end up having to go back through the specification, figure out where the inconsistency was introduced, and tease it apart and refactor and rewrite. So this becomes a big problem insofar as some of these specifications are large and complex, and trying to do essentially what amounts to binary search over specification fragments by hand, just to figure out where inconsistencies exist, is a real pain in the butt. Now, we have developed some tools to mitigate this, to help us narrow down and try to find out which fragments are causing inconsistencies. That's useful on some occasions. But the main way we mitigate this is we have developers instead write those properties from the very beginning, even about small specification fragments. So you can prove the theorems that you know should hold, at least from the literature, about your definitions as you go. And when it comes time to formally verify implementations, the very first implementation we write or generate and we attempt to prove is the bottommost implementation, where everything terminates and doesn't successfully complete normal behavior. By virtue of always failing at those verifications, it gives you some degree of evidence that your specifications are sound. So Dr. Marathis is reminding us to always check our references. And in this case, it means always make sure that your specifications are well-grounded, well-formed, and appropriately shaped so that you don't get in over your head and think that you're a genius because everything verifies, when in fact nothing verifies because your specs are wrong. Lesson three. Lesson three comes from one of my favorite films of all time called The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai. And it comes from New Jersey, played by Jeff Goldblum.
Why is there a watermelon?
I'll tell you later.
This scene is one of the most mysterious scenes in all of Buckaroo Banzai, which is a very cult sci-fi film from 1984. The guys are walking through this storage / workroom, and there's a watermelon in what looks like a press. And Jeff, as New Jersey, says, "Why is there a watermelon there?" And Reno, Nevada says, "I'll tell you later." The point here is that, and so this has developed in a whole meme and mythos around why is there a watermelon, what do watermelons mean, and the like. But the main point here is that oftentimes clients ask questions of, even naive questions of, the kind of work we do using formal methods. And what we find time and time again is even, say, the most advanced clients don't understand the subtleties of what formal assurance means. There's watermelons in our specs, so to speak, mysterious elements that only the experts understand and the clients don't. And the real problem here that we find is that oftentimes clients take on in their heart an interpretation of an insurance case about an artifact in a way where it's hopeful. They hope the assurance case says what follows. And they don't really understand what the assurance case really is. And this leads to considerable problems down the road where you might be building a real thing that moves or flies or operates in the real world. And its overall assurance is based in part on this underlying formal assurance of a component. If you don't have clarity about what that core assurance is, you certainly don't have clarity about the overall artifact. An example of this is the SEL4 microkernel. Impressive piece of engineering and proof engineering, great work out of the gang down in Australia, you know, no longer with us in some sense as a gang with the sad things that have happened at Data 61 and like, but still living on by virtue of the SEL4 Foundation and our friends like Gerno and crew working hard on it. The assurance case for that particular microkernel is something of a mystery to pretty much everyone in the US government, even though there's numerous folks that are very excited about it as an artifact. And there's numerous programs of research using it as a core component. But because it is a, you know, a relatively large, conceptually large piece of technical artifact, and because the assurance case for it is subtle, the clients often misinterpret it. And so the key message here I have is that when we explain what we create, and especially when we characterize the assurance that one should or could have in that artifact, we need to be very plain spoken about it, very honest about it. The set of assumptions and preconditions and underlying invariance to any assurance case about a moderately sized artifact in the real world is typically quite large and complicated and subtle. And too often we sweep under the table those subtleties, not in a malicious way, just in a way that says, well, it's too complicated to explain all that. One key example of this is there's been an enormous amount of applied formal methods work in software that has grown in the USA, especially over the past decade. If I throw a dart at a random Department of Defense program these days, it's not unlikely that it will mention both formal methods and AI, for good or ill. And so there's been a large amount of work funded to develop formal assurance around various kinds of software and firmware artifacts for the past decade. And yet, the assurance cases for these artifacts often neglect to mention that there's an enormous assumption baked into them that has to do with the underlying hardware behaving correctly, the underlying infrastructure behaving correctly, the underlying hardware being secure against various kinds of adversaries and outcomes. And that neglect has caused the DoD to go down a path of building artifacts which they believe to be useful until they start to try to transition it to the real world. And then they realize the hardware that they're transitioning it to has no assurance almost at all, let alone with regards to security properties. So many of the assumptions that were made about the software and the software's assurance case no longer hold. And it ends up being particularly problematic with regards to assurance. So time and time again, we have to focus and be very careful and honest and forthright about the assurance cases that we create for the artifacts that we focus on, and try to help clients understand from their own point of view what that assurance means. And when I say their own point of view, I mean, if you're talking to a contracting person, use the language of contracting. If you're talking to someone who has a legal background or a lawyer, use that background as a mechanism by which to talk about assurance. If you happen to be talking to a computer scientist, then you can use computer science language, as it were, but recognize the fact that even excellent computer scientists who have never worked on formal methods rarely understand what assurance means in the subtle ways. So that's a lesson from New Jersey, is remember that the watermelon is the mysterious artifact that you have in your specifications and your assurance. And if you just neglect the client and say, I'll tell you later, undoubtedly they'll never understand why the watermelon was there. And that might end up biting everyone in the rear end later on. Lesson four comes from the Rolling Stones.
You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. But if you try sometime, well, you might just find that you're what you need.
Sometimes I want to give a talk someday where I can get up on stage and behave like Mick Jagger and dance around like that. It'd be great. So the Rolling Stones message here is that, you know, if you try some time, you might get what you need. And what I want us to remember here, the story here, is that very, very frequently, the clients we interact with, they don't understand formal assurance. And they do believe they understand other kinds of assurance. For example, they understand testing. They understand the idea of unit testing or subsystem testing or end-to-end testing. They understand and gain some satisfaction by having long checklists with lots of green check marks or having progress bars with lots of green and a little bit of red. They understand continuous integration dashboards, which have lots of past, and occasional fails and traces of failures so that you can figure out what's going on. So in general, when we're working with clients who deeply understand and value things like what amounts to runtime verification and testing, we always fulfill those needs. So we focus on making sure that if they understand testing and they want testing, we're going to darn well do testing, but we're going to do testing in a way that exceeds their expectations and leverages the power of formal methods as best we can. That means, for example, we might do very rigorous, measurably rigorous model-based testing, wherein on average for us, about 99% of the tests that exist in the system are generated from formal models. And only a very small amount of tests are written and maintained by hand. That means that we're fulfilling the needs of the client by giving them excellent tests which can demonstrate the properties of a system running on real or simulated hardware, because oftentimes we use things like virtual machines and virtual platforms to simulate novel hardware that doesn't even exist. And you can run these tests on real hardware that has the real CPUs and SoCs inside of them. But what we also do is we make sure to write into contracts and to deliver to the client, not just the generated tests, but the models themselves. And additionally, oftentimes, proof-based assurance that complements the runtime verification. Because we recognize, especially for certain kinds of clients, that down the road, this is going to be what they dearly need. What they understand and they want is the testing, but what they need is the stronger assurance, because that helps them with regards to other kinds of work that may be down the road. It might help with regards to transition. It might help the next team that comes along and needs to understand and evolve the system, because having a small denotational model that they can understand is vastly superior to have 100,000 tests that they have to read over. So in this case, what we always do is listen carefully to what the clients want and what they understand, but also focus on how to give them what you know they need in a way that doesn't trigger them, doesn't offend them, doesn't cause an enormous amount of difference in cost or effort. It's just part and parcel of what you do anyway. So for example, if you do model-based testing and you do your models right, such that they're executable models, and they can be used to generate tests, and you can use them to demonstrate some forms of full formal verification, then that opens up the door to additional work that can leverage those models for either you or others. And we find, in the main, clients always appreciate this extra bits when they come to understand them. So the lesson from the Rolling Stones is give the client what they want, but do it in a smart way, using formal methods, and also give them what they need. Lesson 5 comes from Nada. Nada is the name of the character in a movie called They Live. Carefully look at the billboard in the film. So in They Live, They Live is a science fiction movie that talks about aliens taking over the world. The aliens look just like us. And Roddy Piper here, the famous wrestler, this is his big acting debut, obtains this pair of glasses that lets him see the world as it really is. And so for every billboard he looks at, it has a message on it like obey, money, for example, has the message on it, this is your God. And every publication and every piece of media in the world has messages that keeps the human population under control by the aliens. The message here from Nada and They Live is that the real truth of the world, those underlying messages that exist in the media, are the real ground truths that we have to deal with. The client's ground truths about what they have and what they need are your ground truths, whether you like it or not. Examples of this are as follows. We've had projects where the client is using a certain kind of virtual machine, say, like the Java virtual machine or the .NET virtual machine. And they ask us to build artifacts to reason about such, which means that we need a semantics for whatever instruction set or underlying behavior that virtual machine demonstrates. And it's straightforward enough for us to write or create a model that can characterize that particular virtual machine in a clean way, in a way that is elegant, in a way that's useful, and in a way that captures almost all the behaviors we care about. The problem is the almost part of that characterization. The virtual machine will have a number of other behaviors that we think we don't care about, but the client, in fact, very much does care about. Or we find that the model is, you know, an approximation of a real world, but the approximation is both an under and over approximation at the same time due to design decisions that are made during the model creation. This means that you might have a model and a reasoning system that's useful for reasoning about those models and about realizations of those models. But when it comes time to putting those realizations as programs on, say, that virtual machine, there's no longer a connection between those worlds that has enough evidence or has enough veracity that a client can really use it in a trustworthy fashion and transition into the real world. The main mechanism whereby we couple these worlds together is that we build formal connections between the models and the implementations themselves. So for example, if you're gonna create a formal model of a virtual machine's behavior, then you need a way to execute traces of that model or counterexamples from that model or realizations from that model on the real virtual machine implementations the client cares about, so that you can build that evidence relationship between the real world and the fictional world. And you can moreover characterize very precisely exactly where those boundaries are, if there are any, for the over and under approximations. A recent project that we've been working on, for example, synthesizes hardware designs from formal models. This is in fact how we build our chips at Galois. For the most part, the hardware descriptions that we use in these chips for all the critical components are not written by hand. We write formal models, we reason about those formal models, and then we generate, say, system Verilog descriptions or blue spec or chisel and these kinds of things. And we run that code on the hardware, or we generate the hardware from that code. And what we have to do is, because there's such an argument in the community about the meaning of system Verilog, you know, we may have 6-8 different tools that can execute or reason about system Verilog, and they don't all agree with each other. And moreover, when you take any of those tools and you synthesize a implementation that you're going to run, say, on an FPGA, it too may disagree with the rest. The ground truth is the intersection of those tools' interpretations of the system Verilog, whether we like it or not. And that means that it becomes a very subtle and difficult proposition to couple what amounts to a synthesizer, our tool that creates system Verilog from formal models, and this real world, this real messy, messy world of all these different tools that have these different interpretations. So as part of the assurance case for this overall design flow, we have to couple together the automatic generation of implementations from models to the multitude of interpretations of those generated implementations across all the different tools we use in a fully automated way by running a single sort of aggressive test bench, the kind of thing that will run for many hours, we can generate many, many implementations from models that express different, touch upon different interesting aspects of the formal model, and then check those properties using a multitude of different tools and techniques, everything from runtime verification to full formal verification with tools like Yosys and JasperGold. Only after coupling those worlds together do we have any faith that our formal work is connected to the ground truths of our the ground truths of our clients. So here, the lesson from Nada and the lesson on the billboard, Obey, is about helping us realize that when we build formal models that need to connect to the real world and transition to the real world, we need to give evidence that the ground truths the clients need, the infrastructure they use, the CPUs they use, the virtual machines they use, the programming languages they use, in fact, do relate to our formal models. And it's not just us putting our hands over our heart and saying, I promise it's probably pretty good. We need to have real evidence for that case. So that's lesson 5 from Nada. Lesson 6 comes from Kramer on Seinfeld. This is the ugly baby episode where Kramer sees the ugly baby for the first time and reacts in a typical Kramer way. The lesson here, the story here, is that oftentimes when we use formal methods on client systems, especially when they ask us to assure a system after it's been built, after they very proudly spent a lot of money creating something, you very frequently find problems. And not just, you know, little problems like, you know, off by one errors and like, you might find very fundamental problems about how the system is designed, implemented, or assured, if at all. And the problem is they're very proud of this baby they've created. And you have to tell them the truth. You have to tell them the hard truth that something is really wrong with what you've built here. And you have to do so in a way that doesn't call their baby ugly. You have to tell hard truths, but you have to do it in a gentle way. Now, what I mean by that is, in one system that we built, we were, for the very first time, building some automated reasoning around a piece of code that was important to a client. And an engineer thought it would be entertaining that every single time the tool found a bug in this implementation, we would just have the tool automatically file a ticket with the client. And this turned out to be a very bad idea, because when we ran it for the first time with vigor overnight, it found many thousands of bugs in the system in question and filed thousands of tickets overnight and really annoyed the client, shall we say, because we called the client's baby ugly. And there really wasn't much differentiation here. You know, there wasn't most post-processing of these issues to determine what, how important they were, how they might cluster together, how they might correlate to each other, and the like. So the lesson learned there is, oftentimes when we work with a new technology stack that's never seen formal assurance, whether it's a protocol design or a security proof for an algorithm or an implementation that needs some formal assurance, recognize the fact that you're going to probably find egregious problems, and you need a way to broach that topic with the client in a way that helps them feel like you're not calling their baby ugly. You're trying to recognize the fact that they did the best they could with the resources they had and the constraints they were working under, which are typically even non-technical, contractual constraints, legal constraints, statutory constraints, and that you really want to help them make it better, which means that you have to do either automatically or interactively that clustering, that prioritization that's necessary so that they can witness progress in solving problems by fixing the most egregious core problems with a system by realizing a single fix, you might fix 1,000 of those issues in one go, rather than having to slog through those 1,000 issues in a random order. This means that these days when we build tools that do this kind of analysis, we always allocate time and resources to the post-processing of the analysis, to this clustering and storytelling around giving feedback to the client, making sure that it's understandable to the user of the tool or the client themselves, and helping trace the evidence they have back to the root problem and give them a recommendation about how to make it better, how to make their baby prettier, as it were, rather than just plonking an enormous backtrace in their lap and saying something is wrong here, the system crashed, you know, and here's a stack frame that's 50 frames long. Try to minimize the problem, try to make a recommendation about how things can be improved. Even if it's something that is less about that one error, but more like, here's a small change in your process or method that would globally impact the development of the system, and yet make a large fraction of these issues that we're finding disappear for now and into the future. That is something clients always, always appreciate. So Kramer's lesson is, tell hard truths, but do it gently. Don't, when you look at a system in front of a client, react like Kramer and kind of throw up in your mouth and freak out, because that doesn't make people happy. Lesson 7 comes from Lex in Jurassic Park.
All the files of the whole park. It tells you everything. I gotta find the right file.
So I don't know about you, but when I saw this scene, I laughed out loud when Lex says, it's a Unix system. That's just so classic. That's so great for us. But I also laughed out loud because I know that particular program that she's running. It was kind of a janky demonstration of how to visualize a file system on an old IRIX box running, you know, an old SGI box back in the late 80s or so. It was either exactly that system or it was very much mimicked from it. And the story here is that, you know, this is storytelling for a movie, right? There's no way they could have explained how Lex was going to interact with this computer to solve the problem and save the day and lock the doors, you know, and reactivate the security system so the velociraptors don't eat everybody. So they had to have some sort of pretty but kind of goofy gooey on top of it in order to do the storytelling. So she zooms through this file system, you know, kind of like a very proto Matrix thing, even though this is, of course, 7 years after Neuromancer was written. So the story here that we find to be very powerful is that even in a project that has an extreme bias towards formal methods, we try to never neglect the user interface or the user experience for that new technology, for that new tool. If you ignore or neglect or say, I'll fix it later, I'll add a good user interface or I'll think about user experience later, you never will, simply put. It's hard, it's awkward, it's the kind of thing that not all of us are good at, even if you're a designy type, because the kinds of work that good UX people work do that I interact with are they're able to be very empathetic and channel the thinking, behavior, and feelings of users. They do user experiments. They work with and observe and do questionnaires with users of various technologies. And that interaction they have and that model they build about how people think and work in the real world is extremely valuable requirements that come back to us and help us think about and make design decisions about the tools we use. And this is everywhere. It's not just about whether or not you can build a minimal GUI of some kind on top of your tool or have some degree of interactivity with your tool, like a rendering of a counter example, or couple and embed your tool into an IDE so that users that are familiar with an Eclipse or a Visual Studio Code have an easy means by which to experiment with it and connect and have a user interface that's fluid and useful for them, even for something as simple as writing text. You know, a UI in this instance, in the user experience, isn't necessarily about fancy 3D graphics or buttons that you click on the screen. It can even be about the subtleties of the syntax, the concrete syntax that you define for a new specification language or a new DSL. You need to pay attention to where your clients are coming from, where your user community is coming from, and what they know or think they know and what they understand or comfortable with, to make sometimes what are hard and awkward decisions for us about how that new language might look. You might be someone who's, you know, here a perfect example is that if you're a Haskell person, you think about the world in terms of Haskell, in terms of the typing that you have there, the expressiveness of the language in a very functional way. And oftentimes that means when you create a new, say, specification language or domain-specific language, it'll kind of, if you squint, it'll look like Haskell. This happened, for example, to the guys at BlueSpec. The BlueSpec is a company in Boston, been around for, I don't know, 15 years or so, and they have a hardware design language called BlueSpec System Verilog, which is a lovely, lovely hardware design language, and they recently open sourced their tools for the BlueSpec tools, in part due to troublemaking I caused. The early version of BlueSpec, in fact, looked like Haskell, and in part, it's because the people who wrote BlueSpec core tools, which are in fact ex-Galwegians, are Haskell people, and the tooling is written in Haskell, and so it had a Haskell concrete syntax, Haskell-like concrete syntax. And that user experience was completely and utterly foreign to any kind of end users they would want to attract. It was just not acceptable to anyone but those in the inside. And so they decided wisely that they needed to come up with a new concrete syntax that had a modular flavor of experience that resembled System Verilog more than it resembled Haskell. And this is where they witnessed success. This is where they started having clients use the language and use the tooling outside of their little office in Cambridge. This has happened to us time and time again. Early versions of languages designed by language geeks harken back to the things that they're familiar with. We'll have people that love Python, and therefore it'll be a Python-like language. You'll have people that love C, and therefore there'll be curly braces everywhere and expressions of various strange kinds with side effects. You'll have people that love object-oriented programming languages, and so you have complicated but perhaps unnecessary notions of inheritance and subtyping thrown in there willy-nilly. We shouldn't pay attention to our own biases about what we like and dislike when it comes to especially designing a new language used by others or a new tool used by others. We should pay attention to the user community and try to learn from them and channel them and never neglect the user interface and user experience of our tools and technologies. So the lesson from Lex is exactly that. Even if it sometimes seems silly, I have occasionally spent resources on building what looks like a silly GUI on top of a technology as part of a project. And everyone early on says, why is there a task about this? Why are we building this little thing with web technologies that we all abhor? And yet in the end, a large component of a client's decision to transition to technology is exactly because that silly little user interface exists. And it's sort of a necessary and wise evil to do so that you can do it better the next time and it can witness transition. So let's not neglect our user experiences or our users. And remember, it's a Unix system. Lesson 8 comes from Adam Savage. Adam Savage is half of the pair of guys on Mythbusters with Jamie Hyman. And Adam wrote a book sort of recently. And this is a little interview with Adam about his book.
And it's a lot autobiographical, all the ways in which, all the stories about which I screwed things up in order to learn these lessons the hard way. And the title is based on a thing a good old friend of mine used to say, Mark Buck. And Mark used to say, remember, in every tool, there is a hammer. And he was kind of like being like Mr. Miyagi from The Karate Kid, like imparting this deep wisdom. But really what he was meaning was that you can find something in your environment to satisfy the thing that you have to do. And if it means that your phone becomes a hammer, then so be it.
Now, Adam, firstly, Adam's book is great. If you're a maker or an inventor and you want some inspiration, I suggest that you go to your library and check out Adam's book and read Every Tool's a Hammer. It's very inspirational. And part of his messaging here is that, you know, his tool shop is chaos. It's organized chaos, and it works in a way that his brain works. And it means that at any point in time when he needs to solve a problem that he has in making, he knows where to reach and which tool to grab. But on occasion, he doesn't have exactly the right tool, and he ends up grabbing an adjacent tool, so to speak, that solves the problem, but not quite as well as the actual tool should. So every tool can be a hammer, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's a very good hammer. Now, what that means to me or us in the community is that oftentimes we get very attached to a small number of tools that we hold dear. They're part of our upbringing, they're part of our personality. We learned them while we were doing our master's degree or PhD, and they're the thing we want to turn the crank on. We want to use that tool over and over again. Galois had this problem almost in its earliest days because they were basically a Haskell shop. And for the first nearly decade of their existence, they would only use Haskell to solve any problem. And that didn't mean it was the right tool for the job, but it was the tool they loved most. And in fact, it's still the language used most at Galois, but it's not necessarily the right tool for the job on many occasions. And what we found over the years is that oftentimes, especially with the flowering of the applied formal methods community, the large number of usable projects coming out of academia, research institutions, and companies, especially recently with the large growth in formal methods groups inside of Amazon and Microsoft and Google and others, there are a multitude now of very robust tools that solve different problems. And if you always pull out your same hammer or your same small set of tools to try to solve every job, you end up solving all jobs poorly. So what we do, or the lesson learned here, is that oftentimes it is wise to be bold and a little brave and to be okay with spending time learning new concepts or tools. And not just to solve one client's problem on one project, where it might in fact seem like you're not making progress by virtue of your performers learning a new language or tool early on, but then it's paid for in spades, even on that singular project, by virtue of having stronger results, having increased knowledge and professional development, being able to use these concepts and tools in the future on other projects. And you end up meeting or exceeding the client need because you're using the right tool for the job. I call this karmic. It's, you know, it's much like when, you know, working in the in industry and you're trying to help friends make connections or do hiring or raise some money, you're always trying to help other people because you think that in helping other people, eventually they'll help you. That's kind of how the industry works, at least the folks I interact with. And here it's karmic too. You're learning a new tool to help satisfy or solve a problem for a particular new client or an existing client. And it may feel like at the time that you're not making as much progress as quickly as you would like. And it might feel at the time almost like you're doing a bit of yak shaving because you're learning something tangential to the core knowledge that you currently have. And yet time and time again, we find the time spent on the learning and then the application is completely karmic with regards to the impact that you make, the growth of the team, and the ability for the team and the company to do other new things in the future beyond that which we could do before. So our toolbox may have started at Galois literally with Haskell and Satin SMT solvers and maybe a dash of Isabel in the old days. But now, as I mentioned, our toolbox has dozens and dozens and dozens of different tools, formal methods, programming, specification languages, and others, because we have karmically collected those concepts and tools, which makes us more powerful and capable and flexible as an R&D organization. So Adam's message is every tool is a hammer, but try to use the right tool for the job. And that means scheduling your time and communicating with clients in such a way that you can bake into projects the ability to learn and evolve and to have that impact. Our last lesson comes from Darwin Mayflower in the movie Hudson Hawk, my favorite cult classic, along with Buckaroo Banzai.
Age of 19, it's hard to keep coming up with new ones. But now, finally, I got myself a new goal. World domination!
So Darwin Mayflower is a crazy billionaire who decides to take over the world by controlling the financial markets by creating gold. It's a crazy story. If you've never seen Hudson Hawk and you want to see Bruce Willis be a cat burglar who sings, it's a lovely story. My point here is that, so in my 25 years, so 25 years ago when I first started using formal methods, I thought it would be esoterica, the kind of thing that I really enjoy doing. It would be useful for, and it would be applied to safety, exclusively expensive safety critical, mission critical, life critical systems, and maybe some, you know, intelligence or national defense sort of things. And yet the lovely thing that I've witnessed, especially in the past 10 years or so, is that formal methods are eating the world right now. As I mentioned before, random projects out of US government agencies now are mentioning formal methods. The number of our mutual friends that have gone off and joined FANGAM companies, Facebook, Apple, Netflix, Amazon, Google, and others is enormous, for good or ill. I kind of feel like when someone goes off and joins Microsoft, it's like when they go off and a friend goes off and joins a fraternity in college and you never see him again. But I'm glad they're enjoying themselves and making an impact. But you know, the number of folks that Byron has hired at Amazon or that Dom has hired at Google has just grown tremendously. There's now hundreds of people doing applied formal methods at these companies, making a real impact on real mission critical systems in the real world. It's lovely to see how much has transitioned behind the scenes and is completely hidden to the consumer. It's even hidden to the average computer scientist. You know, we use C compilers like Clang, and inside of Clang, it's doing formal reasoning as part of, you know, optimization, as part of compilation. And yet everybody just thinks, oh, it's just a compiler. The Java virtual machine, you know, does some formal methods inside of it when it does class loading. So formal methods really are eating the world. And it's wonderful to see that in my career when I'm still relatively young. And I hope that we as a community can continue to foster that, continue to do formal methods in such a way that it has real impact. It has the opportunity for transitioning and you're solving real client problems like we saw with Jerry Maguire earlier, rather than doing solely intellectually interesting, elegant work, which I appreciate and do and publish too. Try to find ways to build connections to industry, see some transition, impact the real world by helping ship real working things. So formal methods are everywhere now, in essence. And I think we as a community need to keep doing that. I think that's a great thing. And the more I see companies hiring my friends and folks are going off and introducing formal methods in every single little thing I touch, the more encouraged I am that the world that we witness in computing, especially when it comes to mission critical, safety critical, business critical systems is getting better and better every day. And I think that holds some real promise into our future, where we might see a future where by virtue of enthusiastic companies willing to invest in good decisions in technology like Rust, for example, and its impact, or we might see companies rise up out of the ashes of old ones and really have a focus on correctness and security from the earliest days, we might see some sort of sea change here over the next decade or two when it comes to the not just the usability and utility of our computing infrastructure, but also its correctness, its assurance, and its security. So that's the lesson from Darwin Mayflower, is let's try to do world domination of formal methods and continue to see some transition. So recap, I'll leave this one up while we take questions. I also have a final slide which has the list of media. So I'll leave that up at the very end so anybody can see that in the recorded presentation, or they want to look up any, you know, you're inspired to go see a film by virtue of this talk. So here's our recap, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thanks a lot, Joe. You have to imagine that now there are a lot of people, 50, I don't know how many, 60, clapping you and doing a great
ovation. I use my imagination.
And doing imagination, they are doing the wave and everything. So people are very happy. This is what I imagine, of course. I see some people are writing it explicitly in the chat. So please, people, clap in the chat or express your gratitude to Joe for this fantastic talk. Thank you, very inspiring.
No problem. And I'm gonna pull up the chat here while we're talking.
Yes, also with the added value of the music and the movies. There are a couple of questions. Do you want to take them perhaps in order?
Of course. I can pull it up here. Do you want me to stop sharing my screen?
I think it's you can stop sharing.
Okay, I'll stop sharing and we'll just see me nice and big. Thank you, Anastasia. Okay, so all right. First we have a Yaley. That's a very, very interesting experience. And let me read down the questions. Formal models and implementation thoughts on what academic research can do or to strengthen the formal connection. So that's a great question, Zhang. In academic work, there's this propensity I find for not having enough resources or time in order to do sort of the full model you want. So we're always making these concessions where we say things like, well, it's a matter of engineering at doing the other stuff. So we'll make a type system and we'll have a minimal core type system. And we'll say, well, the rest of it's just a matter of engineering, whether it's proof engineering or software engineering. So concessions like that are understandable for early stages of projects. And yet, if we haven't spent the resources to at least couple the minimal work we've done to get that first publishable result to the real world implementation, we're doing ourselves a disservice. I think there needs to be a trade-off there where you do recognize the fact that you don't have the resources in order to do like the fully expressive semantics or model for the system building, but you still need to not neglect the real world. And so what I've always done as a prof is I always try to find students or research programmers on my team who had the skill sets appropriate to couple the formal and the operational, the computational world, and to spend real resources on that coupling, and to do so in a way that was automated, not a one-off. We need a way to bake into our formal methods essentially continuous integration and continuous verification of coupling the formal models and the technical artifacts, whether it's the execution of something on a real machine or the like. And the way we build a virtuous cycle around that connection is to couple it to real continuous integration and verification infrastructure, where people are applauded for keeping things sane and building new models that really connect to the real world. And there's evidence for such that's generated every time a commit happens and every time overnight large numbers of test runs work. So just make it as part of the virtual cycle of the team and people get rewarded for it. Do I have examples of favorite formal methods tools that have great UI UXs, or at least ones that don't neglect it and therefore they've had impact? Yes, I have several. Some examples are, recent examples are tools that spend time on building plugins for Visual Studio Code, because it's an IDE that's eating the world and it has a very clean LSP subsystem that lets you interact with Visual Studio Code using a simple protocol. So for example, Lean from Microsoft Research has a great UI when it comes to a logical framework in VS Code. Other examples that have like GUIs that would be useful would be things like Upal as a model checker. Some of Robbie's work from Kansas State in the Santos group, working with John Hatcliffe, he always tries to not neglect user experiences. So he builds his tools directly into, in his case, the IDEA, IDE, and uses graphical techniques to render feedback to the programmers. These kinds of things are where I see really utility. Oftentimes it's motivated by these researchers primarily because they're using their tools in teaching. And so you might have undergrads using a tool and there's no way they're going to understand, you know, the rendering of some formula. And instead you need some other mechanism to explain to them. If you can build a tool that's useful to a freshman or a sophomore, it's highly likely that it's also usable to a normal engineer in the real world, because they're at least as, you know, good as a freshman or a sophomore. So those would be a few examples. And I'm sure I could come up with a bunch more. Christian asks, yes, Alberto.
No, sorry, please go on.
Okay. Christian asks, how would you sell formal methods to smaller companies with limited resources and knowledge and willingness to do better? So many of the companies we work with are in fact smaller companies. We don't just do Fortune 100 things. And there isn't a lot of selling there. In fact, Elwha has no salespeople. People come to us with problems and they ask us for advice. And at times we say, we might be able to help you. And if we can't, we introduce you to someone who can. But what we find is where we have an impact there is when people have problems that aren't solvable with traditional means. Or for example, trying to tackle a problem with traditional means would take extraordinarily more resources than they have. You know, programmers writing tests or compute infrastructure to run verification, for example. It's on those occasions when there's a real opportunity to make an impact. And again, we're not selling formal methods, we're selling the solution. They come to us and they say they're stuck on a problem and the solution they know that exists, or maybe a bid they have from another company says it's gonna cost $3 million because they're just gonna throw a bunch of people at it. And we say, well, we're gonna throw two brains at it. It's only gonna cost $250,000. And you can demonstrate the fact that that offer you make is in fact authentic and can be real. That's where we make an impact. The other place where we see impact being made is when companies get over their skis. They make promises to the world or to their investors about a certain capability being developed or a certain assurance a system might have, and they find they are unable to fulfill those promises. And then they end up sort of backed into a corner and they have to make a hard decision about finding somebody to help. And, you know, in all honesty, sometimes that's the kind of thing that triggers a good conversation and a working relationship with a small to medium-sized business. So there's no selling here. It's mainly about solving problems. And if you think the problem isn't solvable, you tell them as much, or you introduce them to somebody who's much better than you at their particular problem to help them solve it.
Joe, I just want to make sure that we are not abusing from your time.
So, no, I'm fine. I'm happy to answer your question. I have no meeting booked next. It's all good.
Okay, perfect. That's
perfect. Cheers. Simon asks, if you should recommend a new technology for a young researcher to learn. Oh gosh, that's a big question. I would say, the earliest things I learned were driven by that. The need I had in part of my PhD work, but also my heart, what I was most attracted to learning and what I thought would be the most fun to work on. At Galwa, we have this principle called joy at work, which means that everybody at the office working on projects or on internal R&D or professional development pretty much only has to do what they enjoy doing. And so we always do the matchmaking to find joy at work. So I would say early stage, when it comes to learning new tools or new concepts that might be applicable to you in your research career or in industry, I would pay attention not just to what's sort of out there and has community that's supportive and has interesting nuggets of research that catch your eye, but also what do you enjoy doing? Where does it take you in a way where you can every day wake up and say, I'm really excited about learning more aspects of this given language or tool or system, and how I might apply that and practice some of my own problems. So following your heart there is a good idea. So for example, learning at some point in your career, a logical framework is a great idea, I think, for any formal ethics person, but there's a bunch of them to choose from, and they all have different flavor, nature, and communities. So picking the one that has the best taste and flavor to you is probably more important than picking the one that's currently hot, popular. So for example, I started my life with logical frameworks using PBS and working in PBS for many years. It's got its pros and cons. I enjoy using it. The PBS plugin for Visual Studio Code is another example of a great tool that's been evolving quickly. But my clients, you know, folks at NASA like PBS, folks at SRI like using PBS, but pretty much none of my other clients like using PBS. I'll still use it for prototyping, for writing formal domain models, for making sure that my models look right at first, because I'm very fast at it. But these days, you know, clients much prefer using Coq or using Isabel on occasion. And so I've learned those over time by virtue of those needs. And I just used the joyful learning I did on PBS as a springboard for the other logical frameworks. Muhammad asks, always have some abstractions in the models. Does Galois have some publicly available document, the formal model correspondence to a real system? That's a good question. We certainly have those artifacts, though most of the systems that have that deep correspondence were built by clients and aren't part of open source releases. The thing that might exist that's closest and open is our tool called SAW. SAW is the Software Analysis Workbench. It helps you formally reason about equivalence properties between LLVM bitcode, so that which you can compile with Clang compiler or LLVM compilers in general, and formal models, or between implementations themselves. So for example, you can prove the equivalence of a Java implementation and a C implementation of two different algorithms. SAW, by virtue of having to reason about multiple kinds of formal models and about LLVM as it's evolved over time, and for which it didn't have until semi-recently any formal characterization, is the kind of tool where an extensive test infrastructure had to be built to couple the real world, that is to say the LLVM tools, and our formal models. So if you look at LLVM, the papers about SAW and how it's evolved over time, and if you look at the implementation of it, which you can download from GitHub, you will see manifest evidence about this connection between real world and real world and formal correspondence. Zhang comes back and asks, talk more about experience in specifying complex hierarchical formal models. Yeah, that would be familiar to you guys. Do you think one would do more testing, like unit testing, on components of a model before composing them in the larger ones? Yes, okay. So when it comes time to reason about models or model code correspondence and using a multitude of means by which to gather evidence, that is to say you to use testing like things, runtime verification, and formal means, we always do so in a bottom-up compositional fashion. We always focus on the leafed nodes of the system, whether they're conceptual or theoretical or implementation, and gain assurance around those artifacts before moving on. Just like you would do with a proof. I mean, it's much the same thing. You need your lemmas in order to solve it, you know, prove your theorems. We have a process and a method we use to tackle systems in this fashion, which include the introduction of essentially automated metrics analysis of specifications and implementations so that we know through evidence where the leaves are and how to build the compositional argument and how to focus on simple things first. And so that evidence tells us basically where to go next and how to triage. And then we work our way upwards through the chain, just like you suggest. And the evidence that we build at each stage is typically both sort of operational testing and runtime verification, as well as formal verification to the best of our ability. The other thing we do is, even in the small, when you're focusing on a given component, we typically do testing-like things, runtime verification-like things, before we even begin formal verification. We use dynamic and static analysis on artifacts first to make sure they seem well-shaped, much like I mentioned earlier, by writing properties about Krypdol and using quick check-like model-based testing to first gain some evidence that what we've written seems good. And only after it seems good and we have that kind of evidence, typically fairly automated evidence, do we turn our attention to doing any sort of formal evidence. And that would be like handwritten security proofs, mechanization and a logical framework, or full functional verification with one of a dozen different tools. So we do it in a staged way, bottom up and left right, so to speak. Okay. Owens asks, do you feel formal methods have lived up to expectations for assurance communications and for system design? Formal methods, so part of what I witnessed maybe 8 to 12 years ago is that many people who read proposals about formal methods or real world impact of formal methods remembered the early glory days and failure of formal methods that harkens back to the 80s primarily. You know, there's a large number of EU projects that were great and impactful, at least from a research angle, back in the 80s, with the flowerings of the early formal methods that I still use every week, you know, like Zed and B and Event B and VDM. And yet the impact that those early formal methods had was small in a sense. It was small in part because of scalability problems of the performers able to use the formal methods and of the tools themselves. They were limited by the fact that almost all the early tools were closed source and weren't shared and were trying to be commercialized early. It was also sometimes problematic from the point of view of the personalities involved and how they interacted with the world. And so there was a failure in expectations then that then percolated over the next 20 years. And so I would say up until maybe 8 years ago, applied formal methods in the real world hadn't fulfilled the expectations of many in the community, nor even some in, you know, clients, funding agencies that might want to see impact. I would say that's changed over the past decade. And partly it's due to the evolution in infrastructure we have, both compute and conceptual, you know, the fact that we have the cloud and we have gigahertz, gigabytes machines on our desks is ridiculous to us old timers. So that helps. Partly it's standing on the shoulders of giants, you know, paying attention to and working off reusable artifacts so that you can formalize more and more, so to speak, and have full coverage of rich modern languages is remarkably excellent. And partly it's because we have multiple tools that help reason about the same kind of artifacts in complementary ways. So I would say that in the main, that's worked really, really well. And what we're seeing now is a evolution in the window of impact and opportunity has moved forward. And now clients want us to reason about even bigger and more complicated things. The real move we're seeing is they want us to not just reason about hardware and reason about software and firmware, they want us to reason about the two together. So the many of my recent projects is about how do you do end-to-end reasoning from basically transistors up to software. And that's a whole new ball of, you know, can of worms, because in general, the people who think about and build and reason about hardware and the people who think about and build and reason about software don't talk to each other. They don't understand each other. There's very few people who do both. And so you end up with real challenges in bridging that gap and connecting those worlds together. Likewise, the number of folks who want to deal with cyber physical systems, where you have what we call bent metal systems, where there's a real system that exists in the real world and it has compute inside of it, but it also has physical properties, means that clients want to deal with discrete and continuous systems at the same time. They want to deal with dynamics that are not simple and linear, and they want to deal with compute infrastructure inside of things that move. And so our, you know, our boundary case for where we can have impact has just moved, and it's now harder, and we just have to have a trajectory toward solving those problems. So I would say sort of for the things that we thought were incredibly difficult and hard, you know, maybe 20 years ago, we've tackled that really well. And the fact that there's hundreds and hundreds of people doing real formal methods in the real world at these main companies is fantastic and evidence as such, but there's still new hard problems to solve. Maurice asks, non-technical question, do you feel you profit a lot from having spent both time in industry and academia? Yes, very much so. It's not easy. You know, of course, once you go into academia and then you, or once you go into industry, it's hard to return to academia because maybe you're not publishing while you're there, and maybe the people you want to work with expect a long list of papers. If you're a systems person and you like to build real systems, that's going to have an impact on how much you can publish because you're spending an extraordinary amount of time building real things rather than writing papers that people read. I chose in my career to build things rather than write lots of papers. I would rather have 10,000 users than 20 citations. That's just how my career has worked out. So I think there's a benefit to it, but you have to recognize that it's a difficult road to hoe. The best way to do it if you do want to have an academic career is to, you know, excellent internships at companies where they pay you well to solve real problems and get you exposed to the real world is a fantastic thing. And, you know, some institutions in Europe or some countries in Europe mandate that as part of your degree sequence, but it's kind of hard to squeeze in one or two internships on a 3 or 4 year PhD. It's easier to do in the USA with a 6 to 10 year PhD, but who wants to wait that long to get a PhD? But I think it's really paid off. The place where I think it paid off most though is in not just working for somebody else, but working for yourself. You know, there's something really to be said for coming up with your own vision, finding some people to tackle that vision with you, even while you still have your academic hat on. You know, starting a company, learning about how to run a company, how to raise money, how to find clients and solve real client needs, put you in a completely different mindset than being driven by that next paper deadline. So I think there's a real value in it that I would strongly recommend to everybody reflect upon if you're early in your career. Antonio asks, in the majority of cases, when you solve a problem for a company, do they adopt the tech approach and invest in it? Or look at you as a magician? Yeah, eating the world should also be shaping it, right? Dead on here. And so the metaphor I use here is religious, though I'm not religious. I'm not going to bring you fish. I'm going to teach you how to fish. Okay. So in general, every technology we create and the way we transition it to companies or government clients is built in such a way that they do not have to rely upon us after the handoff. If you make yourself a magician, especially if you hide some of your tricks where you're not fully open about or willing to teach others about how to solve the problems, you might succeed in that one project, but the project will die at the company afterwards. It won't see transition. So in general, we are always trying to put ourselves out of work is the way to think about it when it comes to solving a client's problem. That means you really have to pay attention to who the deciders are, who the influencers are, and who the users are in your transition opportunity, because they're the ones that are going to keep the project and the technology alive after you're gone, so to speak. We jokingly say that on the teams, you know, none of us, we shouldn't have the bus problem, right? If a bus runs over Joe, the project needs to be able to continue. And so the same thing holds true for our technology. If a bus runs over Galois, we want the technology to survive after the fact when it has transition impact in the industry. And that means we're going to spend more time on educational materials, training materials. We're going to spend time on documentation for the client, both at the source level and developer docs and the like. And we're going to try to find who are the fulcrums in the client that really need and want the technology and the impact to happen so that it will live on after we're gone, so to speak. So that's a great question, Antonio.
Thanks a lot, Joe. I think we don't have any open question. Thanks, okay. Everyone. So thanks for your patience, Joe, and for staying with us more than expected.
It's all good. Happy to answer questions. I hope everybody in Europe time zone will have a good evening and
yes,
have some fun tonight.
Yes. And thanks again for the...
Hi, Jorn. Yeah.
Thanks for the very inspiring keynote. I think the new generations of PhD students and so will find further motivation to move on. And
absolutely. And I should say, if anyone listening, has an interest in following up, if you have any pointed questions or if you hear about something and you want a pointer or a citation or an introduction, please follow up. I'm very easy to find and I'm happy to help because it's karmic after all.
Great. Thanks for the generous offer. Guys, thanks a lot. I would like to hear people cheering and applaud, yes, and clapping, but this is what we have. So thanks again, Joe, and I hope to see you all tomorrow with FMix. We continue with the second session, and there will be a lot of interesting talks tomorrow and in the next days. Thanks again, and see you all.
Have a good night. Cheers.
You too. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Bye.